Tropical storm Isaias is over Hispaniola with a shifting track that has, over the last 12 hours, bounced towards Florida's east coast. The latest models are in as of moments ago, and our meteorologists are live to break them down and answer your questions here on Track in the Tropics. Hey there, everybody. JB Buono here with you live in your hurricane headquarters as we look here at Visible Satellite. WFLA Max Defender 8 meteorologist Julie Phillips joining us here on the right side of your screen underneath me, and underneath her, WMBB chief meteorologist Ross Whitley, who we'll be hearing from here momentarily as we break down Isaias, where it's going to go, this track that has shifted back and forth. A brief reminder, we are going to be taking your questions here from Facebook Live with the hashtags that you see underneath each one of our meteorologists' names. Hashtag Hey Julie, hashtag Hey Ross. We'll be looking for those Facebook Live comments in about 6, 7, 8 minutes time, and we'll be taking those Facebook Live questions and posing them directly to our meteorologists. You have a question about tropical development, about hurricanes, Isaias? We'll be looking for those Facebook Live comments here momentarily. But first, we begin with Tracking the Tropics meteorologist Julie Phillips joining us here in our hurricane headquarters. Hey there, Julie. Keeping a close eye. Now we have a tropical storm as of the 11 p.m. advisory last night.
Absolutely, JB. We are keeping a very close eye on Tropical Storm Isaias. Finally became a tropical storm last night. It was a potential tropical cyclone for a while, but finally is a little bit more organized now. Our satellite imagery showing you the center of this storm is moving over Hispaniola, and that's expected to continue as we head through this evening. Now, compared to yesterday, this definitely looks more like a typical tropical system. Yesterday, we were almost looking at more like an elongated wave, but this is more symmetrical at this point, but it is right now over land, and Hispaniola is quite mountainous, and this terrain can definitely negatively impact tropical systems, which is a good thing. Of course, that's why we have not seen any strengthening at the 2 p.m. intermediate advisory that came out. The maximum winds were still 60 miles per hour. So our visible satellite imagery showing you where this storm is at right now. It's moving off to the north and west very quickly still, at 20 miles per hour. This is not a slow-moving storm, that's for sure. It will continue over Hispaniola as we do head through this evening, and I think we'll have a better idea of the track once it does emerge back out over water. We'll see. There's a lot of talk that maybe the center of this could shift a bit within the storm as it is moving over Hispaniola. So we'll continue to track this. We'll show you the track. You can see as we move past the satellite imagery. There you have it. As we head into tomorrow, expected to move out over the Bahamas. And then by this weekend, we're expecting this system to be somewhere near the coast, especially it's looking more like the east coast of Florida. So this would be as we head into Saturday. Again, you want to look at the whole forecast cone. There is still a little bit of uncertainty with the track of this. So we'll continue to track that. As it moves north, we're expecting this system to remain, again, somewhere near the east coast of Florida, and then curve off to the north and east around a ridge of high pressure out in the Atlantic as we head into early next week. So compared to yesterday, this track has shifted a little bit more toward the east, which is what we were seeing with our model. So that wasn't too surprising. And again, like I said, I think as we head into later tonight and tomorrow, we'll really have a good idea of this track once it does move out over the waters again. Our spaghetti models, we'll plot those for you. You can see, especially compared to yesterday, if you joined us on Tracking the Tropics, a big shift. The majority of the models now actually keeping this off the east coast of Florida. And of course, remember, the eastern side of our tropical systems is where more of the moisture is, more of the heavy rain is. So again, this is a good thing for really the entire east coast. You'd like this to stay out at sea if it could and not cause any issues at all. But we are still fine-tuning the track. You can see those spaghetti models, still a couple of them moving across the peninsula of Florida. But at this point, that is looking a little bit less likely, as you've seen with that forecast cone. We've been tracking a good deal of dry air out ahead of this system, not quite as much as we were seeing yesterday, but there is still some dry air out ahead of it that will impede and really slow the strengthening of this system. So that is working against the strengthening of Isaias. You can see that on our Saharan dust model. This brings Isaias again off to the north and west. This is just aiming at the center of that cone. You can see then curving it around off to the north and east, and likely running into more dry air as we head into late this weekend and into the start of next week. You can see it really facing some of that dry air, and that will likely impede too much strengthening there in the long term. What will help this system is that there is plenty of warm water. You know, it has been hot here in Florida. If you're joining us from the Tampa Bay market, well, we've got temperatures in the low 80s out ahead of this system. So there is plenty of warm water north of Cuba for this system to really run into, and that will allow for some strengthening. So a couple of different factors that we're looking at. And here we have our Tropical Development Index. So kind of taking all of the factors together, dry air, wind shear, as we look at, again, the warm waters, everything. And you can see as we head into tomorrow, I think that's the most favorable time where we could actually see some strengthening with this system as we head to Friday, as it moves north of Hispaniola and near the Bahamas. The Bahamas don't cause as much land interaction issues. But then as we head into the weekend, you notice all of that green that is unfavorable for development, which is a good thing. That's when we could see some slowdown of the strengthening and less working in this system's favor as it then does crawl up the East Coast. So we've been tracking this for a while at this point, and I know some of you may be wondering, okay, so maybe where you're at, Isaias, is not as big of an issue. Maybe you're not as looking at as much of that. Well, there is one other area of interest in the Atlantic right now, but that's pretty much the only other thing that we're tracking. The National Hurricane Center does have this area of interest now at a 50% chance of development as we head through the next couple of days. So we'll show you, it's just off the coast of Africa, and at 2 o'clock they did upgrade that to a moderate chance of development. But in the long term, they're not thinking that things look good for this system. So it is mainly Isaias that we are focusing in on right now in the tropics, but we are not even close to the peak yet. Just wanted to show you this real quick. September 10th is the peak of hurricane season. Again, we're just nearing the end of July. So we have a long way to go and probably a lot of activity to come our way. But right now, Tropical Storm Isaias out there. And Ross, I'm sure you in Panama City are watching this very closely, but as this tracks farther and farther east, I think it's safe to say that you probably will not have any impacts from this system, but still nonetheless, quite a talker for you.
Yeah, absolutely. We've been paying attention to this for the last several days since the PTC designation of the storm. And the good news for us here in the Gulf of Mexico is that we're not talking about much of the way of impacts. And in across Florida in general, it appears that we're not going to be talking of much impacts either. And hopefully this stays off of the Atlantic coast of Florida and nobody has to deal with it. That would be ideal. But obviously there are plenty of uncertainties remaining with this storm. The biggest issue with those uncertainties probably coming with the intensity over the next couple of days, as well as fine-tuning that track.
Absolutely, Ross. And you notice mentioned those impacts. So we kind of go through those right now. Right now, this storm is bringing really heavy rain to Puerto Rico, expecting anywhere from 4 to 8 inches of rain in the Dominican Republic and Haiti. It will then pass over the Bahamas, moving pretty quickly. So that is one good thing. High surf, of course, along the East Coast is going to be an issue as we head through this weekend. Not going to be a good day to be out on the beach as we fine tune that forecast. But the eastern side of this system is where we have the deeper moisture and also the strongest winds. So we do like to look at the whole cone, but it is important to remember that on the western side of the system, we typically see drier air. So if you're joining us from the Tampa Bay area, right now with this track does stay off the east coast of Florida, we would have very minimal impacts here. We would likely actually have less rain than a normal summertime forecast here on the west coast of Florida. And with this track kind of nearing South Florida, places like Miami, Fort Lauderdale, we're probably talking about kind of a wet Saturday before this system exits. And then also, again, we'll have to see how close the system gets to the Outer Banks. If we were going to see a landfall right now, a lot of, you know, the models bring it almost more to a landfall near North Carolina. So we'll have to watch as this track is fine-tuned.
Guys, let's open up the Q&A portion here on Track in the Tropics using the two hashtags that you see on your screen here, everybody, as we get back here to your hurricane headquarters. If you use the hashtags that you see on your screen, hashtag Hey Julie, hashtag Hey Ross, we're going to start to get to some of your Facebook Live comments here, and we're only going to get to the comments with those hashtags because that signals to us that you would like for us to read your name and you would like for us to read your comment aloud. And one of the first questions coming in here, let's get to the first one here from Christina Tony Avila from WFLA's Facebook page in Tampa, hashtag Hey Julie. Do you think it could get stronger and come towards Central Florida? I'll pose this to both of you two.
All right. Well, I think right now it looks like it could get stronger in the next 24 to 48 hours. It's a definite possibility as it moves away from Hispaniola, is over the warm waters. Still some dry air around, but some strengthening is definitely possible. It could become a stronger tropical storm. I wouldn't completely rule out a Category 1 hurricane. Right now, most of the models are trending off the east coast of Florida. So if you're in central Florida, Orlando, Lakeland, again, this is really, you're not going to, I don't think, notice much at all in terms of the forecast. It's going to be drier for us for this weekend. A couple of the outlier models do bring this closer maybe towards the center of the state. Of course, in that case, there might be a little bit more rain as we head into early next week. But that's kind of what we're thinking right now. What are your thoughts, Ross?
Yeah, no, I completely agree with you there. I think this is, if anything, would shift further off to the east than back off to the west. Models yesterday really jumped on board with a breakdown of the ridge across the Atlantic, and that was a pretty good signal that, hey, this isn't going to trend further west. We're not going to see a stronger ridge. If anything, we're going to see a weaker ridge than what's forecasted out there now. So, yeah, it seems unlikely that we're talking about any kind of shift back off to the west. You would have to see something significantly change with the setup of this system, and that doesn't appear apparent. If anything, there might be more of a shift to the north in the short term, thanks to some of the mid-level flow being a little bit further off to the north of Hispaniola, so that we may see a redevelopment of that low-level center, which is over the island now. And in the short term, that would be a benefit for central Florida and western Florida itself, because we would be talking about an initial start position a little bit further off to the north. So I think the biggest concern down the road probably is going to be for the Carolinas, the mid-Atlantic, and then potentially even the northeast. Even if you're not talking about an impact in the northeast, you could be talking about significant storm surge as well as river flooding inland areas there as this nears the Cape in Massachusetts. That would be, to me, the two biggest areas of concern. And as you said earlier, obviously, there's always going to be impacts outside of the center of the storm. So Florida is not out of the woods altogether. Coastal areas are still going to be impacted from the system, even if it doesn't have some kind of landfall.
Using the hashtags Hey Julie, hashtag Hey Ross, we're taking your questions in this meteorologist Q&A here on Track in the Tropics, posing your questions to our meteorologist here in our hurricane headquarters, and Ross Whitley joining us, the chief meteorologist WMBB in Panama City. That's on the Florida Panhandle for those of you unfamiliar with the lay of the land here in Florida. Let's get to our next question. It comes in from Peter Capote from WFLA's Facebook page in Tampa. Hashtag Hey Julie, what will Tampa get? Or will it just be rain like always?
All right. Hey, Peter. I know a lot of people are focusing in on this. But like I've been saying, remember, the western side of these tropical systems actually bring in drier air. So for us this weekend, at this point, as long as this track stays on the east coast of Florida or out in the Atlantic, we are going to be looking at a drier weekend, really, than we've seen in a while. So our forecast, not even looking at any extra rain from the system right now. Again, as long as that track does not change significantly. Like I said, we're still waiting for this to move out over Hispaniola. And once it does so, we'll have, again, even more certainty with the track. But the trend has definitely been east. So as long as we keep this track on course, then we should be looking at smooth sailing here in the Tampa Bay area. East coast of Florida, maybe a little bit more rain, definitely higher surf as the system does move up the east coast, Peter.
Next question coming in from Shannon Lee from Tampa here. Hashtag Hey Ross, this looks like a huge storm. Just how big is it? Ross Whitley?
Yeah, that's a good question. It is a big storm from tip to tip, if you will, from the southern end to the northern end. But we're talking about a broad wave here, and typically when they start out like this, you've got big surges of moisture that are ill-defined, and we've had this big broad circulation for the last couple of days and haven't been able to classify it as a tropical system because it didn't have a closed level low. And now that it does, you see that it is starting to tightening up a little bit more. It is starting to become a little more compact, but we're talking several hundred miles from end to end from this system. So it is a relatively large broad circulation, but with that broad circulation, the biggest impacts that come from that is storm surge. The bigger the system and the faster the forward speed, as well as the radius of the wind field, that's what really impacts storm surge, not necessarily wind speed of the system. So a really large system that has a massive wind field is going to produce a good bit of storm surge versus a very small system that has a very strong wind field that is relatively small close to the center, because it just doesn't push as much water around. So this is one thing to consider, especially if you live up and down the East Coast, is that even if this doesn't get close, we are going to be talking about coastal erosion as well as storm surge along those coastal areas and those low-lying areas, and there's many of them through the Carolinas, the east coast of Florida. You're probably going to see some coastal flooding from this system as well. So size is definitely a factor when it comes to tropical systems. That's a good question.
Again, looking for your hashtag Hey Ross, hashtag Hey Julie questions. The next one coming in from Alicia Howell from ABC27's Facebook page from Pennsylvania. Glad to have some folks from the Northeast joining us. We have another question coming up from the Northeast. Hashtag Hey Julie, my mom is from Puerto Rico. Any idea on how bad they were hit? So might be able to clear this up here, Julie.
Sure, Alicia. Right now, they've just been seeing a lot of heavy rain. They're anticipating anywhere from probably 6 to 8 inches of rain in Puerto Rico. They could have isolated amounts up to 10 inches, depending on exactly where your mom is at. So that's mainly going to be the main threat for her. There are some gusty winds out there. Have seen them, you know, at 45, 50 miles per hour. But in general, I think you know, the main threat for her is just going to continue to be some heavy rain, but the system is moving very quickly. So I'd say, you know, probably later tonight, conditions there should improve rapidly for her. And then things should, you know, start to dry out pretty quickly, as the system right now, the center of it's already over Hispaniola and moving away. But Puerto Rico, as you can see, is on the eastern side of this, where there is a lot of deep tropical moisture. And of course, you know, some of that, definitely see some flash flooding, mudslides, things like that when we do get some of that very heavy rainfall over a prolonged period of time, because the rain started up there yesterday in Puerto Rico. We were already tracking some of it, and it's still coming down today.
Ross, I'm going to throw this next question your way, because you were talking a little bit about the potential for this reaching the Northeast. We got Ann Herriter Robitaille from WPRI 12's Facebook page joining us from Rhode Island. So we got some Northeast viewers again joining us here on Track in the Tropics. Hashtag Hey Julie, can it reach Rhode Island? What do you say, Ross?
Yeah, I think that's a real possibility. As we get into the next couple of days, we'll be able to refine that track. This is likely, even if it does get up into the Northeast, probably going to stay off of the coast there. The issues are that this will be caught up in a upper level trough across the Northeast. So as it does start to race north, and I mean, it will race north. So once it gets to the Carolinas, this is probably going to be moving faster than it already is. And it is booking it, so to speak, at 20 miles an hour for a tropical system that's screaming. This will probably be moving at 25, maybe even 30 miles per hour once it nears the Carolinas and starts to get pulled into that trough. So a piece of this energy will likely stay offshore, but the impacts are going to be much wider reaching than that once it does get up into the Northeast, because it is going to be a part of that trough at that point in time. So you're likely going to be talking about impacts across the Northeast, regardless of whether the center of the storm actually moves across Rhode Island or not. So this is definitely something to watch over the next 48, 72 hours as it does near the southeast coastline, especially if you live in the Northeast or along the Carolinas. The Outer Banks are no stranger to tropical systems, and especially these East Coast scrapers. They typically are the ones that take the brunt of the impact from systems that run like this. So I would be paying attention very, very closely in the Northeast as well as through the Carolinas for this system over the next couple of days.
The next question coming in from Gordy Adams from Fox 59's Facebook page, joining us from Indiana. It's a hashtag KJB question, but I'm going to pose this to one of our meteorologists. I'll probably throw this Julie's way. Does it look like it will get strong enough for us Duke Energy crews to be dispatched? Hashtag KJB. And really quickly, I'll just note, big thank you to all of you out there that are first responders when it comes to hurricanes, all of our power crew workers out there. We really appreciate you. And so for Gordy Adams joining us from Fox 59's Facebook page in Indiana, thank you for all that you do. But Gordy's question here, Julie, does it look like it'll get strong enough for power crews to be dispatched?
Well, it's kind of hard to say until we really fine-tune the forecast a little bit more. Like we were saying, some of the models do get very, very close to the Outer Banks there, so then you could be dealing with more of the rain and strong winds. None of our models are really showcasing this as a storm that is going to rapidly strengthen. Again, the current forecast cone with the National Hurricane Center has this remaining as a tropical storm. And then some of the models, again, have this maybe becoming a category one later on. So that is definitely not out of the question. I wouldn't say this looks like something that's going to be a major, major issue for any one area, but we still have to fine tune that track again. You know, if this were to make landfall, let's say in the Outer Banks, then they could have potentially more widespread power outages there. I'd say it's a little too early to make that call yet. So if you're in Indiana wondering if you're going to get deployed on down, my guess, I wouldn't worry too much about this now, but I wouldn't completely rule that out until we really fine-tune that track over the next day or so.
The next question, Ross Spurlock. You know, we'll throw this Ross question to Ross, considering it's Ross and Ross here from KARK's Facebook page in Arkansas. Hashtag Hey Julie. I'll be in Panama City Beach next week. What's the storm going to look like in the PCB area? Well, we happen to know a meteorologist who's in Panama City Beach. Ross, what do you have to say?
Looks pretty good. I would bring the sunscreen. You're going to see a lot of sunshine. We may have a sea breeze shower or a thunderstorm, but as Julie pointed out earlier, western sides of the systems, you have what we call subsistence, that's sinking air. That usually means that we're drier than our seasonal averages. And so going through the next several days as this system passes off to our west, we're going to be talking about drier than normal conditions across our area, PCB included. And so maybe just a 20% chance of rain as we go through the next week or so. It's going to be very warm. It's going to be pretty sunny as well. So bring the sunscreen and have a good time. Come down and enjoy.
We have the last two questions coming in, everybody. The last two questions from Facebook Live, and I want to make sure that I have the right one queued up. And I do. It's from WFLA's Facebook page in Tampa here, everybody, from Alex Sedano. Hashtag Hey Julie, what is the difference between a tropical cyclone and a tropical storm? So this is probably a good moment to do a little bit of education, hurricane education here, folks, because this was potential tropical cyclone 9 this time yesterday. Here we are 24 hours, and we're talking about tropical storm Isaias. So what do you say, Julie?
And this is, I know, something that has been confusing a lot of people. Just the term tropical cyclone is not one, even if you've lived in a area where we see a lot of tropical weather, that you have heard for a while. And that's because the National Hurricane Center, a couple of years ago, started naming potential tropical cyclones. And a cyclone is basically, it can encompass a tropical storm, a depression, a hurricane. It's the general word for an area of low pressure, a storm that has that counterclockwise flow is a cyclone. So a tropical storm is a cyclone. A hurricane is a cyclone. A depression is a cyclone. So it's saying it was a potential tropical cyclone because it could have potentially become a depression or tropical storm. And the reason that the National Hurricane Center has started doing that was because sometimes these storms don't develop into a depression or a storm until maybe as they're affecting land. So if they're assuming that this is going to be a tropical storm by the time it affects Puerto Rico, they may call it a potential tropical cyclone, so that way they can go ahead and issue tropical storm warnings because they are anticipating that happening. So a cyclone, again, is just an area of low pressure, that counterclockwise flow. It's a general broad name of different storms.
Next question coming in from WFLA's Facebook page in Tampa. Everybody, it's coming from Crystal Miller as it loads up here on your screen. It's hashtag Hey Ross. What are the odds of Isaias changing course and heading into the Gulf opposed to the Atlantic as predicted?
Yeah, that seems very low at this moment in time. I wouldn't completely rule it out, especially if Hispaniola today just destroyed the low-level center and that mid-level center that's off to the north. Then you may see the upper level winds steer this into the Gulf, which is what the models were showing yesterday. That's part of the reason why that solution seemed plausible, is because it showed this thing being destroyed by the mountaintops and then that leftover energy making it into the Gulf as a very weak, unorganized system. But now that it appears we're going to at least see some semblance of a circulation after today, that's less likely, because a stronger system will follow that weakness in the ridge and not be as influenced by that subtropical high that's centered over Bermuda. And that's typical this time of year, that there is a subtropical high in the Atlantic that steers our tropical cyclones. It's part of the reason why the U.S. has to worry about hurricanes, is because that high constantly pushes things our way. But the good news here is that the trend has been further and further east. And until we see any kind of shift or indication that it would be going back off to the west, We'll probably continue to see a shift in the track going further and further east. I would say that once you see one little shift back off to the west, since we've been going east, 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 that's probably an indication of the locked-in track. That's usually how these things go. Whichever way they're trending, when you see one little trend back the opposite direction, that's usually a lock-in. This is going to be the track. So we've seen east, east, east. And until that stops, that's where you'll see the track shifting.
And a final question, we're going to take this really quickly from Ethan Flores-Jones from WNCT's Facebook page in North Carolina, hashtag Hey Julie. I live in eastern North Carolina. The possibility of it tracking more west as it approaches the Carolinas. What do you say to Ethan as we wrap up here on Track in the Tropics?
Hey, Ethan, I would say that is probably a more likely scenario than the question we just had of it tracking into the Gulf. Affecting Eastern Carolina, I'd say, is a definite possibility at this point. That's not going to come more until Monday. So I think as we get through tonight and then into tomorrow, once we see what the terrain of Hispaniola has done to the storm and see where that center of circulation is and how strong it is as it moves off and continues on to the north and west, that's when we'll have, again, an even better idea of exactly where this system is going, and our models will probably come into even more agreement. So right now, I would definitely watch this closely. Stay tuned, as, you know, some definite impacts could be felt in the Eastern Carolinas early this coming week.
We appreciate the thousands of commenters who were filing questions here on Facebook Live through the power of social media. We appreciate all of our Track in the Tropics super fans joining us from the respective television social media platforms for our sister stations across the United States. We're here, of course, at WFLA in Tampa, live from your hurricane headquarters, but we have meteorologists joining us every Wednesday and even more frequently than that here on Track in the Tropics as we continue to cover the 2020 hurricane season with now the development of Tropical Storm Isaias. So for WMBB's Ross Whitley, chief meteorologist there in Panama City, joining us via Skype, and WFLA's meteorologist here with Max Defender 8, Julie Phillips. We appreciate you joining us. I'm JB Buno. We are back whenever there's significant tropical development worth telling you about, folks. We're always here ready to stream at a moment's notice live from your hurricane headquarters. Our normal episodes are Wednesdays, 2 o'clock Eastern, 1 o'clock Central. You can have that every single solitary Wednesday throughout the 2020 hurricane season, but we'll continue to monitor Isaias and provide you updates as they become available from the National Hurricane Center. For Ross, Julie, I'm JB. Thanks so much for joining us here on Track in the Tropics. We'll see you soon, everybody.
Thank you for watching Tracking the Tropics.